Okay, I'm Linda Cole. I'm Deputy Town Supervisor. I will be presiding over the work session this evening. We're all present except for the supervisor, who will be back next week. And let's approve the minutes. Is there a motion to approve the minutes from February 8th?
I'll move to approve February 8th minutes.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Monthly reports, we've gotten a lot of them. I'm not sure if they're all in or not. Anna hasn't told us, but I suspect they'll all be in soon. And we don't have any public hearings. We don't have any guests. We have action items. The first, the action item, is the mixed-use DGEIS discussion led by Mark Valentine. Mark?
Ms. Cole. This is something we've brought before the board several times. Looking this evening whether the board is supportive of moving forward with setting a public hearing for the draft generic environmental impact statement. What I passed around was kind of a perspective path forward, depending on how we go tonight. We'd sent you guys the initial copy back in February, and most recently, I believe on Monday, I got to check out the latest version of the document. So this is the basically the meat and potatoes of it is 100 plus or minus pages. So it's a response to the original scope that this board approved. It was back in September of 2016. So we have the draft scope. Basically, this is a response document that answers the questions that came up in the scope to that. This big binder here on the desk is actually all the appendices that go along with it, is the attachments to that. So we've been working with our secret consultant, as well as Doug Fox, to make sure this document is prepared in true direction, pull it together, make sure it's complete. We believe it's a complete document at this point, and looking if the board is supportive of setting a public hearing. So would constitute putting a resolution in on April 5th, which would set the public hearing date for May 4th, if the board is comfortable, and then we kind of just roughed out some days. You know, they're kind of going beyond that as obviously as we're putting it up, once we have the resolution in place, we'll put the document online, make it available for public comment. We'll have a hard copy here at the library for public review. We'll collect those comments and then come back to this board, share the comments if there are any changes needed, and then that's when you move into an FEIS as the final document based on the public's response to that, updating it from there.
Okay, any questions?
Will the public be able to comment online like we've done in the past with,
yep,
with proposed plans?
Yep, we'll put it up online and then they can provide responses
form
there. We'll have hard copies if people want to see it in person. So we'll have it set up both ways.
Yeah, I'm fine with the schedule. I think it is worth noting that the recommendations on the mixed-use zoning district were presented to the town board from a voluntary committee.
Mm-hmm.
I know, Jim, you were very involved in it. So were you, Mark.
Yeah.
Committee members comprised of Penfield residents, property owners in that vicinity, or you know, the adjacent property owners, mm-hmm, and also residents that represented surrounding neighborhood associations were a part of that volunteer committee. So it really was a citizen committee that made the recommendations to this town board. And I just, for the record, think that's worth noting and thanking them for all their efforts and help in doing that.
It's a good reminder. It's a long process.
It's been a long time coming. I mean, this was something we did get some support from the county and GTC for it. Thank you to them as well. But this could be a model for other communities around the county. So they've kind of looked at us to come up with a model and push something forward that other towns could use.
Okay. So very good. You'll put together
I'll prepare a resolution for your April 5th agenda, and then we'll set that public hearing.
Okay. All right. Hold harmless agreement for loading dock and easement at Baytown Plaza.
Jim, if you would. This is currently, once you get the sketch, kind of orient you to the what the photo is. Basically, it's a top-down site plan view of the existing Walmart building. So not the new building, the old building that's left vacant. Currently a pending application before the planning board. That'll be on the April 12th agenda. That was supposed to be in March. Again, with the storm events, that was delayed. But pending before the planning board is they're looking to renovate this building, do a new facade on it, bring in some new tenants, some new people to that.
What building is this?
This is, was the old Walmart building.
The old Walmart.
So right at the end of the plaza, you kind of see the tops piece. You can see the end of Building D is kind of the end of that plaza. Baytown Liquor, and that is in the area. Once Upon a Child. So they're looking to kind of break it up into some smaller tenants in there.
Right.
One thing they need is a central loading dock in the back. So that central loading dock could pull up. There's a common hallway in the back, you know, that feeds. So these are the angled parking. You can just see the new Walmart building to the top. And then that central corridor would feed these additional tenants into there. What is happening with that central loading dock is a portion of it would be over one of our sanitary sewer mains. They're proposing to replace the main. They're also going to sleeve the main, so if we ever have an issue with it, basically it's encased in one pipe's encased in another pipe, you can just slide that pipe out, so it gives us access to it. So they would need, obviously, site plan approval from the planning board for the site plan revisions.
Wait, was there a loading dock there for Walmart?
The current loading dock for Walmart was off the north end of the building.
Okay.
So the current loading dock is somewhere in this location at the north end.
Right.
But with the new layout, and this was all kind of considered as part of that overall plaza, was to move it slightly angled to the back. The pavement's already set up that way. The wall and the berm were set up for this configuration. All is consideration of it.
Okay.
But it's going through that, just that they are encroaching into one of our easements. They need to.
It's not affecting the neighbors behind you because you have the berm and so on?
Yeah, the berm is remaining. It's not, everything out there is going to remain exactly as it is
planned,
right now.
It's just.
The berm is actually larger than
yeah.
it was.
Yeah, the berm, they had more dirt, so the berm was higher than what was planned. And
this request was part of the plan all along. It's just, this is one of the, is it a final to-do item in
yep.
terms of the easement, granting
yep.
them access?
The pavement was installed. It was all,
so it's not
it was
being
all considered
moved
as,
or?
Nope, it was all considered with that original.
Okay, this is holding harmless. Have you discussed it with the town attorney? Is this a?
Obviously, we'll run it past Mr. Horowitz and have him sign off on it. You know, but with them replacing the pipe and then sleeving it as well, so we'll have a brand new pipe in there mm-hmm. and then being sleeved inside if we do have to.
Encased in concrete?
It is not encased in concrete.
Right.
We can just pull the pipe out if we ever had to get under there or if they're in our easement and we had to get at it. You know, that's what the whole harmless agreement is for, is, you know, they'd have to.
Yeah, I certainly have no problem with the standard hold harmless. I think that I just want to certainly reiterate that this is not detracting or change at all in the approved plan that went through the planning board.
No.
It's just a formality.
This is just another step in the process now that they're repurposing that building, and it's good to see that they have some tenants ready. They're interested in going in. They're going to do a whole new facade change to it, so it'll be a good.
So time is right to do this.
Yep.
Okay. Everybody good?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay. Next, 24 Maya Drive, hold harmless agreement for a fence and a sanitary sewer easement.
Ms. Reza, and okay, I'm just make sure I didn't say it incorrectly.
Is she going to introduce herself? You're the one on Maya Drive?
Yes, I do.
Yep.
And what's your name?
Karen Reza. I own the house with my daughter, Jamie Leibowitz.
Okay.
Mr. Reza approached me, and I'm sending kind of two plans around. One shows an aerial photo. It's a little dated. It kind of shows it under construction. And then it shows the green line in the back, which is our now a town-dedicated storm sewer. So this is the Abington Place development, so off of 250.
Right.
Abington Place. Ms. Reza lives there on Maya Drive, so she's at number 24. She's looking to put a fence in on her property. With the fence on her property, we do have a storm sewer that runs kind of parallel to her backyard. And I went out there today, took a picture standing on top of the catch basin. So the first page, you're looking south along the back there. It is a 20-foot easement, so she is looking to put a fence inside of that because she'd like to go outside of her landscaped area.
Right.
I'm okay with it being outside the landscaped area, but I do have an issue with it being directly on top of the pipe. It's only a 2-foot deep pipe, so potentially you could either puncture through the top of it or block drainage. So I'm recommending, you know, a 4 to 5 foot offset of it, run just right along the back of her landscaping, leaves the pipe out of there. Obviously the whole harmless agreement, if we ever have to do, go in and dig up the pipe, you know, Ms. Reza understanding that, you know, we may have to remove the fence to do that. You know, that doesn't happen very often, but just there is the potential for that.
So he explained all that to you when you talked to him about it as far as the placement of the fence and you're
yes,
okay with that?
I guess I would clarify only for my contractor and my landscaper to make sure that we are doing that correctly.
And I can meet out there with them for that.
Yeah, to make sure that we're doing that correctly. There was previous landscaping that berms that we spent a lot of money on, so we don't want to have to pull that in if we don't have to, but certainly understand that we have to be away from it.
Yeah, and you certainly don't want to have your fence in a position where it might get damaged or compromised.
Absolutely.
The integrity would get compromised by having it.
I think when he goes out there again after we have spoken, he's going to try to do it so that we're really not even in this situation, that we're far enough off. But I think I need to be sure, because I don't know all the technicalities, but Mr. Valentine, I'm sure, will explain that my contractor is doing what he's supposed to do.
Sure.
So,
great.
So how far are you within the property line? The fence would go in?
I'd say it should be 4 to 5 feet inside the property line. So it'd be slightly off that, but basically the pipe runs right down the center of the property. So
gotcha.
Half's on a neighbor, half's on her property. So if she's in a few feet, at least it's just not over top of the pipe. You know, if you draw a straight line down, you know, her berms are probably 7 to 8 feet inside of that. So she should be able to fit a fence behind that.
Oh, yeah.
The berming and the landscaping would be inside her yard. It's just that the fence wouldn't be exactly on her property line at the rear.
It would give us more area to work with in the easement area as well.
It gives us room to work.
It's not uncommon. This happens all the time.
Doesn't. With the shallow pipe,
yeah.
You know, we just don't want it to be augering through or drilling through the top of the pipe and damaging the.
And we want to make sure that your contractor doesn't have to redo anything. So
absolutely. We want to, just a sidebar on this, I had approached Mr. Valentine. My grandchildren, who I live with, and my daughter, he was just diagnosed with autism. He's 22 months old. So we have to provide safety for him, because if you know anything about autistic children, they wander. And that's why we're putting the fence up. But we want to be, you know, we don't want the additional expense of doing it incorrectly.
Right.
You know, and we want to get it done as soon as possible, because spring is coming and we want him to be able to go out and play.
Sure.
I mean, certainly never unsupervised, but we want to, you know, to keep him very safe.
Sure.
So.
Okay. Anything else?
No, I'm good.
We're all good?
You enjoying Abington Place?
I am.
Good.
We are.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you for coming.
All right, thank you.
And would you mind that I leave, because they're
no,
home?
No.
And I don't want you to think I'm rude with my grandchildren at home.
They might
be so
envious.
That's true of everybody.
I'll follow up with you.
They're not home alone, they're with my daughter. Thank you.
I'll follow up with you and your contractor, and then we'll have to
absolutely.
Sign
thank
the papers
you,
and everything else.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Okay.
Thanks.
Good night. Okay, the dental office is 2105 Five Mile Line Road. Jim?
Yes, we had our public hearing on the dental office on March 1st. The staff, as I indicated at the meeting, really had few concerns. There are a couple things that we want to work out. We're good enough to work with the applicants yesterday. They came in to visit us, and we talked about the issues of regarding the potential for the need for a sidewalk in the four corners, particularly in that area, as you've got a lot of people trying to move back and forth through Liberty in that area to their driveway that goes over Dunkin' Donuts and everywhere else. The other issue was the height of the building as it related to the ground level. We thought that they might be able to bring it down a little bit or do something to accommodate so much exposed foundation wall, and they were looking at that as an option. Gentlemen, why don't you come up and sit down and we can talk with you. And then the other issue I brought up, which is really a non-issue because Bob has been working on it since day one with the other tenants, is the cross-access and parking agreement. And that will be put in place just as a normal condition. If you could talk a little bit about the building after our discussion yesterday, that might help the board.
Well, if it's about the building, I think I'll yield to John because he's the architect.
That's great.
I'm John Page, Bureau of Architecture. Hello. So, the two issues that we talked about were the elevation of the building, which is, we confirmed that the elevation of the first floor was generally set by existing site conditions and where the building was going to be accessed. And of course, when we studied it from a design standpoint, we were certainly conscious of the situation about where the building would be and the height that it would be. We were pleased that we had a one-story building. It was a commercial building, but as I stated before, you know, we went for something that had a bit of a residential feel to it, a traditional residential feel, and there was a decision to have a nicely sloped roof on it, and to in the linear space that we were given, to have the cross gables for relief, and then other things that we came in on. So what was determined, I believe, is that we could drop the first floor a little bit and still work with the parameters of accessibility from the parking area, and work with the what is a shared driveway between three buildings in that area, and that we would study and drop the building 6 to 12 inches. The other, and I also wanted to explain that there's a little bit of a problem with in my profession, when you're working on building small buildings like this and trying to work on a budget, and you draw the standard drawings, which is an elevation, and what you see when you see an elevation is a good architectural representation for the purpose of building. It can sometimes be confusing because you're going to see a rectangle, and in the case of this building, you're going to see a rectangle, and that's what you're going to see. But what you see in reality, this is the eave of the building, and this is something that is pretty far in the distance at that point. So it's a little misleading in terms of the height of the building. So that was one aspect. The other aspect, I think, that was discussed in more detail was the advantage we were trying to take of grade to add a little extra light into the basement area in the center area underneath the cross gable, and so there was more exposure. Now we've already had been planning, and it seemed to be acceptable to the preservation board to put a coating on there so that it wasn't like exposed block. We also, through Scott, submitted a very detailed landscape plan. So one of the things that was asked, and that I brought a couple of copies, and I'll pass it around, is a drawing of the Liberty elevation with the landscaping in place, so that we'd get a better feel for what we're actually proposing to do out there. We believe that the landscaping that's being proposed will further mitigate the what you might have as a concern about the exposure of the foundation above the grade.
So is this rendering here a new rendering since we had the public hearing, is what I'm gathering?
Yes.
And you've taken into consideration some of the concerns?
It's a response to the concerns that we raised with them yesterday.
Yeah,
and we talked about if they were going to keep the building at its current height, could they work with us to do some landscaping to kind of break up the foundation?
Is this the project review committee met?
Well, Mark and I and a couple of us did, yes.
Yeah, and by the way, we are very appreciative of that we have the opportunity, and that you guys are willing to work with us in a way so that we could try to get a better understanding of the questions and provide better answers when the time came today.
Mm-hmm.
So these are proposed trees to be planted?
Yeah.
The large ones?
Well, I mean, they won't be large initially, and
right.
But that's what they will grow into, and they'll actually probably grow even bigger than that in 20 years.
What kind of trees are you want to plant?
Do you remember what they're crab apples, if I remember correctly?
Deciduous trees?
We did a complete landscaping plan that was reviewed by architect.
No.
I'm not sure if I have it with me.
Check. So while he's looking at that, you basically took the landscaping plan that
was approved
already looked at, and superimposed it now into
the
town landscaping consultant, just for the record, has taken a look at
yes,
it.
Yes, he has.
My only question about the trees certainly is the sight line at this corner.
At the intersection.
So, I think the building itself is going to be set back at least when you look at Liberty, the queue, at least a car, maybe a car and a half, but if you plant a tree right there at that corner, then you're going to start to shrink that sightline. So I would just suggest, I mean, I know this is a rendering, but before planting those trees, Mark, Jim, Bruce, you may want to go out and just make sure that when it grows up, it's not going to be...
A good sight distance.
Yeah.
Yep.
Agreed.
You might think of shrubs or something.
The other comment I have is,
need a third tree.
As liaison to the Historic Preservation Board, they've certainly taken a good hard look at this. I know they offered up some suggestions. Jim, can you just synopsize
I know you were at least two of those meetings with
us. Yeah, synopsize a little bit in terms of what their concerns were and how they were addressed.
Well, this has been an evolution since they started, and I think this is the end product of the evolutionary process for the board. One of the big things that they were concerned about is they wanted to make sure that it just wasn't a rectangular box. And I think that they've worked with the board to bring out and create some relief on the building. This actually is offset from the wall. It's not just one flat wall. It does come off the wall. It does give relief. They've done some architectural features like scallops instead of just clapboard siding on like it is up the rest of the building. They did play with the roof line and the eaves a little bit to resolve some of those issues. And I think the board, generally, they do like the building. I mean, they like the design, they like the front porch area. That's a nice component to it. So, and they did come in and they asked for double hung windows, which you see now in this final plan versus the...
They were quite lively, as they usually are in terms of their
offering. You know, we work with Bob a lot, and certainly John, and Greg, they've all stepped up and kind of responded to the board's concerns. So I think the board's pretty comfortable with what the final product.
How does the signage room fit on these?
I think we haven't really talked about wall-mounted signage yet. I think you're looking really more for freestanding signage, and I'm sure you'll have some wall-mounted signage on the building.
Possibly, yeah. There's some signage from Bob's tenant are there right
now. Put something in the corner.
Yeah, we need to work with you. We'll work with you come up with a plan. The board's going to have to approve some kind of a directory-type signage for both of you now. And we certainly talked about that with that tenant when they came in early on, so they're aware that it will happen. I think we're just trying to wrestle through this right now. In terms of where you might want to think about wall-mounted signage, it's just a function of taking a rendering that you have now, plotting it on there to scale, allowing the board to review it, determine that it's appropriate. The Historic Preservation Board will also have to review it, and everybody's in agreement, then you can move forward with a permit for that.
Is this new rendering anything, does this need to be?
This is the original rendering. This is the one they submitted as part of their application.
And this is the new one. So I'm just comparing them as to whether, I don't see anything that is so substantive that the Historic Preservation Board needs to take a look at it again.
I suspect it's the
lighting downstairs, they changed. They don't have the
foundation.
The foundation.
Did you take the windows out?
Windows.
No.
They're still there.
They're concealed by vegetation.
Yeah.
We wanted to get it more accurate to the landscaping plan. Okay.
No, that's good.
It just brings to mind the question, really for you, Greg, is it the intent to have some kind of activity in the basement area other than just storage?
Well, right now what we discussed is where I'm working at now, I have an auxiliary lab in the basement with some lighting there that kind of helps me out. It's just where I deal with a lot of stone and stuff like that, so it keeps the dust away from the upstairs and stuff like that. So I have an auxiliary lab down there. Just I have lighting too, but the natural light obviously helps me.
Right. And then the other issue that we talked about with them yesterday was the fact that the town policy is to require sidewalks along property frontages, and certainly when Bob refurbished the old barn, it was an existing structure, you all remember, so he wasn't really obligated to do that at that point in time because there was no new construction per se. If he had added on the addition to that barn, he probably would have had to have done it. We determined at that time it wasn't required as our site plan requirements, but secondly, if he had built a structure, he wouldn't have been required to do that. This is an issue, and Mark kind of brought it up the other day. If you have somebody who's in a wheelchair, for instance, and they're coming off a 5 mile end road trying to go down to Liberty, they're kind of in the road doing that. Mm-hmm. They're not on a sidewalk. I know there's some things going on there, some electrical stuff that has to be addressed. I know a lot of the trees are coming down, so there's not going to be a lot of obstruction in terms of being able to work behind poles. But the PRC's recommendation was to have the sidewalk installed along their property frontage up until the driveway.
Jim, I made up some photographs to share with the board members.
Yes, we talked about that yesterday as well. He did want to show you some of the obstructions that are in the area that they were concerned about.
We have multiple copies, so everyone should have one. If you could just pass those down, please.
And you did notice that the county PRC comments came in, and they were numerous, which kind of surprised us. And it turns out, really, based on discussions with the county, that they will be required to get a permit for tying the sidewalk into the sidewalk that exists on Five Mile Line Road, which a portion of it is in the county right-of-way, portion isn't. So that's really the issue at hand for them in terms of all the comments that came out of the PRC memo that you saw.
They were all DOT comments.
Yeah, they were all DOT comments.
I guess our position on the sidewalk is that we'd like to not do it. And we noticed from the photograph shown there that there is a sidewalk on the north side of the street. And I don't personally have the history of the development as, and I'm not as knowledgeable as Bob is, so I think, Bob, it might be your turn to speak about it.
Yeah, on that access road and the entryway coming into our area, if we run that sidewalk on the south side of the road along Liberty near the new building, it goes to a point where, one, it's not going to go all the way down the street. It's just going to stop at that intersection. And, you know, there's a concern there of public safety where you have people standing on that corner between the two entryways, the side access road and then the entryway coming into the development. Because right now they go on the north side and then they cross over. You got people stop and they're on the other side of the road. People come out of that access road and they don't look, they don't stop, they just pull out. So, you know, the concern about people walking on the same side of the road is a concern.
But especially the kids on the sidewalk, they're not on the road.
You're on the corner of the sidewalk and the access road and the access entryway. So you're gonna be buttoned up, not against Liberty, but the actually road.
The drive-in.
And people, as we all know, you've gone out to the site, you've visited, you've pulled out of that access road, people don't stop. And in my opinion, having the people on the other side of the road away from there is more safety. And that's why we actually put that sidewalk and that crossing on the other side of the road that came to our side of the road. This way, the people are held up on the other side of the road, and they're not in that intersection. I think it's a concern, and I think we got to think about it.
What's the recommendation of PRC regarding sidewalks?
We think it's within the four corners. I think walkability is huge. It can be on the back side of the pole. We're recommending just bringing it to his first driveway, not all the way to that rear access to Canandaigua National Bank. But,
okay. So bring it to the banks?
But why stop there? Why not
bring it?
I mean, there is a sidewalk running from the crosswalk into the back, correct?
Correct.
So why not bring the sidewalk?
I mean, we can bring it to the end of his property. I don't think he directly abuts that sidewalk piece. I mean, it could be a piece we could add, you know, as part of our sidewalk program.
Well, it is part of our property, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, Rob, you're showing the crosswalk across the way.
Yeah, I see that. I don't think it shows the road or the...
This is the piece he's talking about, still the cross. We're saying bring a sidewalk. I kind of sketched on in blue, but to here, then obviously you can either stripe a crosswalk here if need be. That brings it in this way. Eventually, we could, you know, continue the sidewalk all the way down to the Canandaigua National Bank entrance here. As we talked yesterday, if you're coming out of the four corners, you're handicapped, you come up here, now you've got to cross over this intersection over to Liberty Street, come back across here, because this is going to be a staircase. This has a retaining wall all along the road here. Okay. This is stairs, so you got to at least you stay on the same side of the road. You can cross the driveway, you're not crossing Liberty Street twice. You come up into the property, because here's their handicap entrance. You got to go all the way around.
So the handicap entrance
to the parking lot, and then over here is the handicap entrance to the building is at that end.
So they're going to have to go through the parking lot to the
door. You got to go through the parking lot, pretty sure. Within their property.
You'd have to come in, so it's not hitting.
I mean, sidewalks are essential to the Four Corners district. It's kind of the nature of the neighborhood. It's different than other districts.
Yeah, I mean, I'm in favor of a sidewalk.
I would think at some point in time we would have to...
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. At some point, the idea here is that it's a commercial property and it's sort of ringing the neighborhood. I mean, it's like framing where we have the businesses, and I think it would make sense to have a sidewalk at that location.
Yeah. Yeah, anything new in the Four Corners, we've talked about connectivity, walkability, that's what we strive for, you know, so... Be hard pressed to.
It is a village. That. I understand. It is a village, yeah. And a village is made to walk around.
Right. Okay.
You've said that many times.
I know.
Jim, have we got comments from other people since the public hearing?
We only received one email from Vivian Claren, who is somewhat critical of new construction. I think she feels that there's just too much being put in the Four Corners per se, whether it's this site or others. And I know you have copies of that material and I've reviewed it. But again, legally they're permitted to develop the site. Mm-hmm. They meet our criteria for development.
Yeah, but the applicant, from my perspective, is not a new business to the Four Corners.
No.
His business is moving existing the in the Four Corners. He's no. just moving it across the street and building his own building. So it's not as if someone else is coming in. To your statement, I would argue that he's already there. He's just moving his business across the street.
And even if somebody else new was coming in, the owner of the property has the right to develop it meeting our code and design criteria requirements. Yeah.
And just for the record, because they know that there was a comment, I believe, that came in, or part of the comment that came in regarding that the commenter saying that there's so much, that there's vacancy in the Four Corners. And that, can you speak just generally, because I know we've had this topic come up before where we have a couple eyesores, so to speak, or a couple vacant buildings, but overall we're at over 90%.
That's correct.
Occupancy in the
we're
Four
about
Corners.
93 or 94% at this point in time, and a lot of it depends on, you know, relationships between tenants and their landlords and landladies. It depends on a whole bunch of different things, but generally speaking, if you look at the Four Corners now, the one vacancy that stands out is obviously the old.
Because I've had
property.
To educate, you know, just inform residents who've brought up that misperception, and that is a misperception. It's, you know, some newer residents haven't been around long enough to really know the history of the Four Corners and parking and whatnot. Like we have known for so long.
Well, and you know, and I think this is a great thing to have the town board looking at this in terms of being able to adjust to parking conditions, because this is the reason why you're doing what you're doing with this zoning district. It obviously doesn't meet any setback requirements at this point in time. Parking's always been an issue. I think you've done a good job of balancing, and I think the applicants have done a good job of balancing out their uses so that they're not impinging on somebody else's parking requirements. And certainly you've done that. You and Mark Crane have done that. It's worked out fairly well. I think you're seeing a lot of new redevelopment, a lot of new improvements to the Four Corners area over the last couple of years, and I would expect it to continue. Yeah.
One question was asked at the public hearing about garbage pickup, whether you could coordinate with Mark.
We'll look at that, yes. Most definitely, if that helps out traffic and conditions, we'll take a look at that.
And more importantly, not so much the frequency of pickup, but when it's picked up.
Right.
I know we're having a lot of problems in certain areas of town with residents concerned about early pickup, 5 o'clock in the morning next to
3 o'clock
in the morning.
4 o'clock.
So that's something we're working on.
Okay, do we have anything else? Are we ready to move forward for a resolution next week?
Okay. April 5th. If you're comfortable with what they're proposing with the landscaping as it relates to the foundation height?
Right, I think it's an improvement what they've put forward tonight.
Yeah, and can we circle back to the Historic Preservation Board in terms of not holding up the resolution or delaying it all, but just let them have for their record or their reference the new rendering and that the landscape plan was approved and had input from our town landscape.
And actually, if you remember, and I think we're both of the sessions, one of the things we brought up was the fact that once the landscaping plan was finalized and there was a visual of that, we would bring that back to the board for its final review, and they're waiting that. And we have our meeting, I think, the day after the, it'll be on the 6th of April, so it shouldn't be a big deal.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I will echo what you said in terms about the occupancy of the Four Corners and the vibrancy and kind of a little bit of a resurgence in the last couple of years. And residents have noticed that and been very positive about it, about the Four Corners.
And I'd like to thank the applicant for choosing to stay in the town of Penfield. So I'm sure you could have gone to any of the other surrounding towns or the city of Rochester with your business, and you chose to move across the street. And so I think that is a good thing, that businesses want to be in this town and be a member of the Penfield community, particularly the Four Corners community. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Resolution next meeting.
Start preparing for your review and get it out to you. We have an extra week this month. So
I know. All right, thanks, guys.
Thank you.
I was a surveyor and an engineer up there in the corner of the bank.
They were scouting for that.
Yeah. Did they get their project approved?
Have you seen the Monroe County boundaries? What it looks like?
Yeah, that's a rather quite trick, right?
Because there's no woman up there.
No.
Just thank you. I've been doing a lot of times. Did you notice that?
Yeah, thank you.
Good night.
So the next on the agenda is the K2 Brewery. I want to come up, guys. Please.
Gentlemen. So again, we have Brad and Kyle Kennedy. We had our public hearing on the 1st as well. One of the things I want to pass out to you is something I prepared. They did not, but I took their information and tried to interpret it into what I think they're trying to do here. We had our public hearing. I think some of the things the board was concerned about, and generally we always are, with the new restaurant facilities, is to the use of outdoor dining, outdoor music, for the first year or so. I am going to show you what they're proposing for outdoor. Outdoor is not to create a new deck or anything like that. They want to utilize the existing landscape area behind the building. They want, and it's kind of hard to see because I use green, unfortunately, but they're looking. I tried pink.
The only pen you had left over from St. Patrick's.
No, I.
Black didn't have worked, or.
Black didn't even work. It didn't look good. So, in any event, what they want to do is they want to. I think it's probably one of the white vinyl type fences or a cream color type fence, incorporated around the perimeter of the back of the building. The slope does start fairly close to the back, so the area that you see is still flat or fairly flat. They're not looking to install any type of decking or patio or anything of that nature. They want to take 10 picnic benches and tables and put them out there for seating for 4 or 6 or whatever it is.
So fenced in all around, proposed?
Yes. There's a, behind the building right now, there's a shed, and they want to stay to the north side of that shed and utilize that as a demarcation area so they're not going to the back further. There is about, I think when I measured it out, it came out to be about 3,200 square feet of area. So there's, to have 10 picnic benches, they would certainly meet the state's requirements for.
And it's an outdoor seating area that, as I'm noting on this map here, is the opposite of the residential.
Right.
Area.
Right.
It's
I did take the time to measure. I wanted to see in my own mind how far their outdoor area would be if there ever was to have music on that site to the exterior. They are 951 feet from the edge of their outdoor area to the wall of the house up on the cul-de-sac of Old Westfall Road. And then I measured further down Old Westfall till you got to, I think Mrs. McGrail came in and she was concerned, and rightfully so, because we've all been through that with Bayfest over the years. I don't think that's what their intent is, but she was at 3,100 linear feet from the back area. So.
Well, if those apartments get approved by planning board, won't that be even
Well,
closer?
That's a ways off if they're going to do that or not. I don't know. But I was just looking at it in terms of,
existing.
Distance, in terms of music carrying and that kind of thing. So it's a ways, but
regardless, you'd never anything beyond acoustic. You know,
No.
I grew up on Parkview Drive up
Definitely
on top
not.
Of the hill there mm-hmm. in that Bayfest. I'll never forget, I mean, my parents lived on the far side, more towards Ellison Park, and, you know, and you sit in the backyard and you could hear the singers, the words out of their mouth.
Yeah.
It was that far away yet so clear because of those hills, you know, the valley. It was amazing.
Yeah, that's not the clientele we're looking to attract either. We want easy listening, quiet.
People can hear themselves talk.
Yes.
Yes.
Want
sip
it.
Their beer and
people,
yeah.
you know,
relax.
People want to enjoy yeah. and not have to scream over the music.
Right.
Yeah. So the other thing we talked about was traffic and traffic safety and traffic movement. And obviously, as you know, that is a privately owned road, mm-hmm. and they do not own it. They have the right of access to it. Things that we were thinking about internally here at PRC was the fact that we may want to look at installing no parking signs, having them install no parking signs on the private drive with the
yes.
owner's permission. We can't go in and do that because
right.
it's not a dedicated road.
Uh-huh.
Just to ensure that, I mean, it is getting a little tight down there with
yeah.
the vegetation, so, and they're more than willing to do that. We've talked about
that
these
issues.
That
can really help.
One of the things they've also tried to do is they've tried to contact Frank Bodine, who owns Agway. They mm-hmm. would like to work with him to see if they could create another stone parking lot, maybe in this area here, mm-hmm. to create additional parking. I think they're going to need it. I think they think they're going to need it. I hope they need it.
Yeah.
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 They only have 51 spaces now. One of the things they asked me is they could utilize this area for parking, which we own. That's access to the pump station. We can't ever let anybody park in there. That's got to be, we may even cordon that off with a chain or something, mm-hmm. just to ensure that they're not having to go out and be the watchdog for that. But they'd never be able to utilize that. If we had to get to that pump station in an emergency like last week,
mm-hmm.
We'd never be able to do it with the number of vehicles that would be in there. So
right.
we're looking at those kind of things.
Mm-hmm.
I did have the fire marshal look at the seating capacity under the state building code as to how much area they had. He did a calculation for me. It actually, based on the amount of square footage they have for their seating area, they could actually have up to 120 people on for seating. They don't want to do that
no.
because if they go over 99 seats, they have to put a sprinkler system in. And we have, and that's pretty much true of just about everybody who's got a small restaurant. They don't
yeah.
want to do that. So, you know, they've set it up for 99 and it meets that criteria. And I think basically those are the big issues at hand. I know you want to utilize the existing sign. You'll have
yeah.
a new sign where the existing one is. Oh, and then the other thing Mark brought up, thank you. We will be coming to you soon and asking for your permission to move forward to create something like a new Lou amp, like we did at Route 250 and 441.
For Empire.
For Empire.
For fire for traffic safety at Empire.
Mm-hmm.
And what our intent is to hopefully get the culverts widened out by the state DOT at some point in time. We're going to meet with them soon to talk about that. If those culverts get widened out at the creek, it would then give us the ability to continue that middle turn lane down through Empire Boulevard, at least to the town line, if not further. We would, you know, we're looking not for one person to pay for this, but we're going to start collecting funds to get enough to be able to go and do it at some point in time. And that's how we would do it, is through the development process.
Having that loop then.
You know, in fairness to them, we don't know what those numbers are. It's all based on ITE traffic generation numbers and all that business based on the use. So we would be sitting down with everybody who's involved. Based on what their uses are, they would contribute to that fund so that at some point in time we can get this done. Because I think that's the only way we're going to get done.
But I think that'll be a betterment to all the businesses along that corridor. If you have a safe refuge in the middle, waiting to make a left or pulling out, you know, they call it a Texas two-step, but you can kind of pull out, wait for the other set of traffic to
yep.
go, and then pull off from there. So
right.
we've already shared with Dr. Howitt, is the potential developer in the back, and you know, he said he's more than willing to contribute to a share in that. And I think as we have other developments come in, you know, if each person kind of paid a piece, as we've done with Luamp, you know, that we've used for interconnections here, I think it would be a great benefit to get that middle turn lane down. That would be a benefit to McGregor's and, you know, all the businesses along there to have a safer corridor.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
The Kennedys actually went down and looked at, there was a comment made, I think, by Mr. Schnepp about how the area's been broken up a little bit, and they've actually offered to try and do some work in getting that cleaned up as well. I think we're working with the RG&E to see if we can get something from them to do it, but they want it to look nice too, because obviously it reflects on their business if it doesn't look good. So they're willing to do some things to work on that. that's not, you're not obligated to do that, but I commend you for wanting to do it, and I, you know, will certainly support you on that. We'll have to get some permission from the state DOT to work within the right-of-way. We'll have to get permission from Dr. Howe to work without, outside the right-of-way, but we'll do that, and I'm sure it'll come together for them.
I would just comment that, you know, you mentioned Mr. Schnapp on Wilbur Track Road. I think it was a positive that you had a resident so close who was quite supportive of your endeavor. That was good to hear, especially from a resident who's been very involved and very aware of what's been going on in the area. My suggestion there, and it's a suggestion that I think we've kind of given to other businesses in the past, and they haven't heeded the suggestion, is get to know your neighbors. And, you know, the more neighborly you can be and the more kind of hospitable you can be to your neighbors, you know, I've mentioned in the past and businesses saying, you know, hold a soft opening, invite the neighbors, hold some sort of gathering for the neighbors to come and see what you're all about and meet you. We have some business owners sometimes who are just, they're afraid to meet and interface with their neighbors. And you can prevent a lot of things from occurring if you get to know the neighbors. It sounded like Mr. Schnapp was certainly amenable to your product. So I would just suggest that, you know, postcards to the neighborhood that say, you know, we're going to, or you know, some sort of special for them when you open up. And it's just, I think a little bit of hospitality can go a long way in terms of the neighborhood there.
To be clear on the food end of it, what were you thinking of for
trucks? Occasionally maybe, but we plan to have a small kitchen. Fryers or anything like, or open flames, but like panini presses, pizza ovens, so those type of foods. So soups, salads, sandwiches, pizzas, basically. Nothing where we need extra fire codes in the kitchen or anything like that.
Pretty close to what Knuckleheads is doing.
Basically.
We're trying to stick to deep fryers and stuff like that.
But having McGregor's,
we don't want hoods.
I would want to try to compete with them on each side where, you know, if we can offer something small but they can substantiate while they enjoy beverage but not
have to. And you're still going with the plan of the residence for your parents?
Yes.
Yes.
I could see, I'm glad you brought that up, actually. I could see that being a very popular thing to do with food trucks in the summertime. You don't have a ton of parking, so I think a lot of it's going to be predicated on getting more parking before, because you're going to have to give up your own parking spaces to accommodate the food trucks, let alone the clients.
Definitely.
So we're going to have to work with somebody to get additional parking in close proximity.
And your hours of operation again? Because they're different.
Most days, Friday and Saturday, we might go to midnight.
You're off Monday and Tuesdays?
Yes, off Monday and Tuesday.
Yeah. When would you like to open?
We would like, if everything goes through, we'd like by end of summer, August, September would be nice, all depending on approvals, closings, and our
licensing
and our equipment.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
There you go.
Yes. There was one other question that eludes me for the moment now.
I know what it is.
Please ask.
It's why you don't have a cool hat like your brother.
That's a good question.
He's more Irish than me since you guys sat down.
He's more Irish than I am.
That's scary.
My wife was watching, she comes, she goes, nice hat.
Yeah, I agree.
And your parents are going to eat for free, right?
Well, that was the benefit.
Put that in the resolution.
They're living for free on that and everything, and in return for the help. It'll be nice with my dad as the contractor. My mom is a retired, she's been a bookkeeper for 30 years, so she'll be able to do our books. And my dad's retiring as a contractor. We're hiring him on as an employee, and then that'll be the retirement. And he's always throwing pottery, woodworking, so he'll have a workshop to be able to sell out products. And then even like our mug clubs, he's going to make them out of his own pottery, and people get to keep them at the end of the year every year.
Oh, cool.
Actually, the question was directed to you. And again, we have talked about probably holding off on the music until we can get a better handle on happening down there.
So.
What is your perception of enclosing the area for picnic tables? I suspect you would have people out there drinking and eating at the same time.
Mm-hmm. I think it's fine.
I'm fine with that.
Is everybody okay with that?
Yep.
All right.
Yeah, we like to make sure people filter in and out through us so we can see, and nothing would come out from the outside that we wouldn't be able to see and monitor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if you're thinking about opening, you know, like you said, late summer, early fall, that gives a good year, will give a good cycle of seasons too, as far as that music, and that's, you know, see how things flush out. And we have had businesses come back and alter what their original intent was, and so it might help you as well to have that year cycle through before you expand in terms of music and things like that.
Right. When you say a fence, are you looking at a 6-foot fence or a fence that you can actually see the road and still see?
We know that Jim had told us limit is 6 foot. We haven't decided which.
What do you prefer?
Like a privacy fence?
We thought privacy, we were thinking just privacy, because it would cut down from road noise. Right. Other breweries that we have been to, a lot of them are on the road. And when you sit there, you hear the road noise.
Yeah.
You know, so the privacy would be nice, but if we had a view of, if there's a view of the bay, they would probably keep it open, but it's more blocked with the trees.
Yeah,
so
yeah, you don't.
I think privacy would just make it secluded, especially with the hill there. A green space with the greenery on the hill would just be a nice
And I think also, don't we probably prefer being enclosed in terms of access? You know, people not able
well,
to walk.
I think the state liquor authority will require to be fenced.
Yeah.
Right.
I think the fire marshal will require a gate to allow access in and out. But I agree with you. I mean, all you're really looking at is our pump station, and that's not the most attractive.
No.
In the world, so.
So we'd probably go with a higher privacy fence, but it definitely be completely enclosed, you know, with a gate for
I defer to you guys. I was just curious because if I were sitting at one of those first two picnic tables, honestly, I don't know if I were standing there what the view is. If you could see the view of the lake or the bay, and it's a different story.
Not really from there.
If you can't, then that's
the second story.
The second story, you definitely can, but that's future plans. Okay. So.
The ladies that own the place now did a phenomenal job over the last, I got to commend them, they're not here tonight, unfortunately. They did a phenomenal job over the last several years of maintaining the landscaping.
The building's beautiful.
And actually even took it upon themselves to cut down the roughage on the hill so there was better sight distance. They've been doing that. Is it your intent to continue to do that for sight distance? It just benefits your property and your business. And then you'll maintain the gazebo and everything else they've got out there now.
Exactly.
Okay.
So you're buying the property?
Yes.
You're not leasing it?
Correct.
Oh, we're buying it.
Okay. Good stuff.
The ladies are retiring.
Yes.
They had a great run.
I did.
They really did.
Yeah.
And all that jazz.
It's been a while, hasn't it? It's been about 20 years.
Oh, yeah.
You were there a while.
You've been there quite a while.
Okay.
So next steps are?
I'll prepare a resolution for your review. Mm-hmm. You can make comment to it, edit as you see fit, and I will get it cleaned up for you. We'll put it in for the April 5th meeting.
Great.
Thank you for being so organized. You know, we really appreciate it at the public hearing, too.
Thank you.
Not everybody comes in with such information and clarity of purpose and understanding Penfield.
Jim's been a great help to lead us along.
Yeah, they had a great
don't say
you won't get rid of them.
Yeah. All right.
Thank you.
Good luck, guys.
Okay, that's it for action items. We have one information.
I just want to bring to your attention, Tony and Mark and Andy and I are working on several code revisions, and I know you're aware of them. We've been talking about them for the last year and a half, 2 years. Some relate to the DPW. One relates to the electrical code insurance costs. We're going to lower that down to be more competitive with other towns. There were some technical corrections that needed to be made, small technical corrections in the ordinance. Once we put it together, we went back and started reading and found that we had to do some minor things to bring up where it was before. So they're all going to be prepared for you. We'll probably talk about it again in another work session before we bring it in. We're probably a month or two away from that, but we are gathering everything right now for you. We're hoping even possibly if we can get the ordinance for the mixed-use district maybe put together for you in a reasonable time frame to make that part of it, unless we have to do it on its own merit. We'll do that as well, but hopefully fairly soon you'll get some of the stuff in here to look at, and some sign issues that we've been dealing with. And I know, Paula, we had talked about some things in terms of trying to open the businesses to get some more time for outdoor events, that kind of thing, in the ordinance a couple of years ago. We're looking at that as well, so we'll get that to you as quickly as possible.
All right.
Okay, well, thank you.
Sure.
And that's all we have on the agenda, so can call the end of this meeting. Our next meeting will be on April 12th for the work session. Our town supervisor will be back, so.